What's up, y'all?
Chaboy here to make another prediction about the future of gaming and how we might even be able to fix it. Okay, so because I'm a new creator and I can't get YouTube's account verification to work for me right now, I'm just going to post part one right now, but part two and maybe a part three are coming. Poisonous practices in gaming are a dime a dozen right now. Every gaming YouTuber is talking about it, so I figured I'd put in my two cents. It's even gotten so bad now that elected state treasurers are calling Bobby Kotick for a meeting. And these state treasurers are asking him for a meeting because gaming is so big that each of these states have investment in his company. Yes, the state you likely live in invests state funds in these companies.
Damn!
The company hired to investigate Activision Blizzard, SOC Investment Group, is also investigating other gaming companies as well. If you go to their main website and you just scroll down the main page, you'll see that 9 out of the 21 main stories they have on their main page are about gaming companies they're currently investigating. Most of the stories are about EA or Activision Blizzard, but still, they're mentioned 9 times on their main page.
9 times.
9 times.
This gives a pretty accurate insight into the state of gaming, or at least the gaming industry and how they're made. I mean, they're so bad they have to send corporation investment groups after them just to see and investigate how bad they are.
The pain train is coming! Let out! Let out! It's in there! Don't hurt me! Please don't hurt me!
The gaming industry is not the only industry with these problems, but it does highlight an important issue of how game developers and QA testers are treated in the workplace. There's talk of them starting a union, or there has been since at least 2018 that I can find evidence of, and I fully support this because, in my mind, they're the talent of the gaming industry. I hate to always compare the gaming industry to sports, but there's so many parallels. Like how in the early days of the NBA, how the players were just treated like such trash and paid so little that they had to get part-time jobs just to maintain their NBA careers, while the owners made multi-million dollars in the 50s and 60s. And how the NBA fixed it was through a players' union that still exists today. This is literally the only reason that guys like Chris Paul will make $100 million. In my mind, these game developers need agents and contracts that are standardized throughout the industry.
Did you ever see The Twilight Zone where the guy signed a contract and they cut out his tongue and they put it in a jar and it wouldn't die? It just grew and pulsated and gave birth to baby tongues?
They need some sort of representation during the contract negotiations, because obviously it's too one-sided and it's not working out. When Bobby Kotick will come home with $100 million plus in 1 year, and your average game developer only makes about $80,000 a year in the US, there's got to be a middle ground we can reach. I mean, shit. These devs just must get abused in the contract talks.
I, Pootie Tang, do surrender to Electric Core all the rights to my image and likeness.
So?
Oh, yeah? Yes. I will wholeheartedly endorse all Electric Core products and will do my best to convince the children of the world that the above mentioned are all clean, safe, and should be bought and used by all of them.
No. Not the tip it has, no.
No, no.
Let's just say, for number's sake, Activision has 1,000 developers. I know they might have more than 1,000 developers, but it's just a nice number to do math with, so it's the example I'm going to use. Activision made $8.1 billion in 2020. Now, $154 million of that went to Bobby Kotick, just him. Now, if you just take a quarter of his salary, which ends up being $38.5 million, and then you divide that by 1,000, it comes out to $38,500. That's $38,500 that each developer could extra get on their check. So each developer could honestly be paid somewhere in the neighborhood of $120,000 a year instead. Which, I mean, isn't a huge number and isn't, you know, doesn't make up for it. But it's still, that is a small change that would make such a big difference in these developers' lives just by using a quarter of the CEO's income. It's hard to be passionate when you're struggling to afford your home.
Hey, mister! Change! You got change?
If you're only making $80K a year in the Santa Monica, Los Angeles area, I mean, you're barely getting by, probably. Their cost of living is insane. This pay gap is not exclusive to Activision Blizzard. It is pretty much every big game company that acts this way. As of 2018, the Epic Games CEO, Tim Sweeney, is worth $7.2 billion and is now 194th on the richest man in the world index. So basically, the CEO of any big game company is a billionaire.
Lots of money. Play.
Yet they pay their developers pretty much the same across the board. And QA testers are treated even worse than devs are. And this shows in every new release. Some of these new releases, I swear, nobody even turned the game on and played it before they released it. If this continues, it's going to turn into a flood of games that nobody wants to play, or they're so full of pay-to-play or pay-to-win aspects that playing them is too big of a waste of time. It's going to turn into what happened in the 80s with Atari games, where there was a flood of all these games that came out, and there was no quality control behind these games, and some of them would just plain not even work in the Atari. You'd turn them on and the controller wouldn't even move anything on the screen. And I mean, we're not that bad yet, but it's getting close, and it's the modern equivalent of that. And you know how the gaming industry fixed it? It was all Nintendo. Nintendo fixed it with their quality control system and their official Nintendo licensed product sticker they put on the boxes of the official Nintendo games. It was basically the only way to tell that someone at Nintendo had played this game, tested it, and it was good enough to be released by Nintendo for their system. This basically guaranteed the customer that at least if you hated the game was going to work. It would turn on, the controller would do something on the screen. In my opinion, we need something like this again. We need like an association or a way consumers can look at the game and see, oh, this game was endorsed by the Gaming Quality Protection Agency, so it's going to work when I install it and play it, at least to the advertised level in the description. Like, there's nothing wrong with game companies releasing games that aren't done. Just don't tell us they're done. Or, like, say, you know, the multiplayer's not going to work right yet, but the single player works right now, so go ahead and play it. We'll charge you half price for now, and we'll charge you more when the multiplayer comes out. I honestly can't see any gamer really disagreeing with that. Nor do I see how it loses them any money in the process. This is one of the main reasons that I think video game hype is so dangerous today. But that's a topic for the next video. But honestly, if we had some sort of international agency that would take each of these games before they came out and tested them with certified testers that were tested and vetted through systems and proven that they were worthy of burning through a game nobody's played before and finding bugs that most people would overlook or miss, you know, and also to check like continuity between systems and simply just report on what works and what doesn't before the release, and then consumers can make the decision to buy it or not right away. It would make a huge difference. The hardest part about making this happen, though, is making this association or agency something that all the game publishers and developers would want to join. It would have to make the impression that your game won't sell as well if that sticker's not on it. Kind of like the Oprah Book Club sticker on books. Like, if you don't have the Oprah Book Club gaming seal of approval, like, your game's just gonna sell for shit. And if we had some sort of agency like that that could force some quality control on the games, not to mention also force quality control on the contracts developers and game companies make with a set of standardized contract negotiation rules, this would also incentivize developers to, you know, be more creative and get better at their jobs too. If they knew they could get a higher salary, if they created better games or were on a game team that made like the next GTA 6 and it took off and was awesome, and then they could go get a contract at another game company that paid them like double what they got before. Kind of like, you know, when a quarterback gets called up off the bench because someone else gets injured, and he goes in and wins 9 games in a row and finishes out the season in the playoffs. And then the next year, he gets picked up by another team, and his salary goes from $1 million a year to $10 million a year just because he had 9 good games in a row. There needs to be that opportunity in gaming and gaming development for developers to be paid for their art and paid for their talents. That some of these talents are unteachable. You can't teach people to draw some of these characters and or write out these incredibly advanced and creative storylines. Some of it's just straight up amazing. And some of it's so amazingly toxic that I'm like, it would take a creative, evil person to think of this. And I think Asmongold explains it best in his review.
Now, the high watermark system is, in my opinion, one of the worst endgame progression systems that's ever been conceived in an MMO before. At level 60, you begin with your watermark system at level 500. And then, as time goes on, you will loot pieces of gear, and as you loot a new piece of gear, it has a chance to watermark your prospect of gear that you will loot in the future. So you are looting 500 pieces of gear until you loot a 502 piece of gear, and then you have a chance of looting a 504 piece of gear or a 503 piece of gear. So you have to do all of this up to 600.
It makes me think, like, what if I was a kid today and, like, I got as addicted to some of these games as I did to, like, The Legend of Zelda or, like, Wolfenstein or Doom. I feel like these kids are just going to grow up later and look back at these games and be like, damn, that game was shitty. I was lied to. And we get to look back on games like, damn, that was one of the best games I ever played. Still, it just makes me sad that kids won't get to experience that, because I highly doubt anyone's going to look back on the beginning of New World and be like, yeah, that's a classic. That was killer. Unless games of the future are basic gambling simulators to the point where all you're addicted to is the flashing lights and the sight of you losing. And unless we do something, I mean, that's kind of where it's going. These glorified loot boxes are just legalized gambling. And more lucrative they get, the more and more part of the core gameplay they're going to become. Unless checks and balances are instituted, there's nothing stopping it from happening that way. But the idea for an oversight group for these game companies, I think, is an awesome idea. And honestly, I don't think I'm alone if I say that I would gladly pay more for a new release game if I knew it was going to come out working the way they said it was, and that I knew that good players had honestly tested this game and said, you know, hey, it's good to go. I don't even think it would be too much to ask for the regular price of a game with this quality assurance on it to be $100 on release. I mean, a lot of these special edition games are already that much anyway. If it means that developers will be treated correctly and paid right, and quality assurance people will be certified and also paid correctly and treated right, it's totally worth it to me. Just to know that, like, one industry I love is at least trying to be more ethical. Because, I mean, if we want change to happen at all, there has to be some give and take. We as gamers can't just ask for everything and be like, you know, pay everybody more and give yourself less money. And, I mean, these are all things that people have been saying throughout history for every industry that has ever existed. These are not new problems. They're just new to gaming. But honestly, I'd rather pay for the game to win rather than pay for me to win at a shitty game that doesn't work. Because I'd much rather lose in a working game than win in a shitty one. All right, well, that's it. I'm out for now.
Peace.